Hello and welcome to the Cypher Brief. I am Iya Meormishuli, the Chief International Correspondent here at the Cypher Brief, that have the pleasure of speaking with Nico Lange, who is the Senior Fellow at the Munich Security Conference, as well as the Center for European Policy Analysis, CEPA, based in Washington, D.C. So, Nico, thank you very much for finding the time to talk to us today. Let's start from Ukraine. What's the latest from the front lines? How do you assess the situation? What do you think is happening at this moment?
Now, it's a mixed picture because the Russian attacks in Kharkiv Oblast, they have come to a halt, and Russia could not even take the small city of Vovchansk under control, where Russia is fighting right now. And I think some Russian troops are having serious trouble there. But at the same time, Ukraine had to use reserves to fight in Kharkiv Oblast, and Russia is continuing to push, especially toward Pokrovsk, and is making slow but steady progress. And then there's, of course, the city of Chasiv Yar, where fighting has been going on for a couple of months now. Russia is very, very slowly progressing, but Chasiv Yar is a good point for the Ukrainians to defend because it's on high ground. There is a channel in town, so it can go on for more weeks and Ukraine can use it. I think the most dire situation is not so much on the front lines. It is the energy situation and the overall living conditions and the Ukrainian economy. I think this front is really in a very bad condition at the moment. Possible financial problems of the Ukrainian budget and the energy situation, I think, making people think whether they stay or leave during the next months, but especially when fall and winter are coming.
Do you think Russians will advance in Chasiv Yar? And maybe to connect with this question as well, you mentioned that the reserves were called. How bad really is the manpower shortage for Ukraine?
I think Chasiv Yar is specific, one of the few places with high ground where it's possible to have relatively good defense positions and where it's very difficult for the Russians to take over. At least it will take a very long time. But if you look into the Pokrovsk direction, where also because of a Ukrainian mistake, there was faster progress, if you remember that some weeks ago in Ocheretinye, there it seems the Ukrainian armed forces are not really fully equipped with material and with personnel. First of all, undermanned units trying to hold the Russians back. And this is strategically a relevant direction because the city of Pokrovsk, I think, is not only bigger, it also has a much higher real significance if you compare it to Bakhmut or Avdiivka or other cities we talked about before. I think that's the reason why the chief of the military committee of NATO, Admiral Rob Brauer, just a few days ago, gave the hint to Ukraine to speed up the mobilization effort, to man the units, to have the soldiers trained. I think it's really necessary to get more Ukrainian soldiers to the battlefield.
So they are really, sorry to keep pressing on this, but so the manpower shortage is a major issue for Ukraine at this point.
It is an issue because the political discussion about the new mobilization laws took too long. I think everybody, even in Ukraine, agrees on that. And now, of course, soldiers need to be trained. And also, Ukrainian soldiers are not Russian soldiers. We are talking about people coming from a self-confident civil society. They are asking questions. How will I be equipped? Is my commander a Soviet-style commander, or is it somebody who makes responsible decisions? All these questions, I think, are very legitimate. They need to be answered. But it is not making mobilization faster. And that's, I think, from a military point of view, it is a real problem. And at the same time, the new equipment now coming in, Russia is trying to exploit the deficits, especially when it comes to manpower, spreading the front lines thinner with the attacks in Kharkiv Oblast, probably also in Sumy Oblast. Even if Russia is not achieving very much there, they can still make life difficult for forces that are undermanned anyway. So mobilization and stabilization of the home front with economy and energy, those seem to me the most important issues for the Ukrainians right now.
How is the U.S. equipment that came with this latest package of assistance, how is it trickling down? You hear some reports from the front that not everything has reached the destination. What are you hearing about that?
It takes some time for equipment to arrive. Also, the military logistics, 2 years into this war, I think they are strained now. And also, I think we all should put an effort into improving the logistics and the forward logistics of the armed forces of Ukraine. Mm. Also, with bringing maintenance and repair closer to the front lines, bringing contractors in, I think there are important matters to attend to. Logistics is more difficult. The equipment is coming in. I think in many areas of the front line, the artillery ammunition situation has been steadily improving over the last weeks. There are the known deficits when it comes to air defense systems and air defense ammunition. This is not covered by the packages yet. So this is a problem that needs to be solved very quickly. When it comes to mechanized equipment, it's good that the US decided to send more Bradley infantry fighting vehicles. The infantry fighting vehicles seem to be even more important than the battle tanks. But having them repaired at the front lines, having spare parts, allowing the Ukrainians to produce spare parts on their own, I think all those things need to be decided now to make the effort on mechanized equipment more sustainable. Same is true for artillery, where barrels need to be changed. I mean, why not having the Ukrainians produce their own barrels for US-delivered equipment and change it in Ukraine and not wait for the spare parts to come over the Atlantic? So there are upsides with the ammunition coming in, but there are, I think, also serious downsides that need to be addressed.
Based on everything that you said and sort of progression that you've been seeing, both from the Russian side as well as from the Ukrainian side, what would your expectations be for the rest of this year and possibly even next year, if you can, if you're willing to go that far out and predict something?
Yeah, my prediction at this point would be that this year and the next year are very likely to be years of war. So militarily, I think we are far away from decisive battles or strategic decisions. And politically, I think everybody is waiting for the result of the US presidential elections. And there are also other significant milestones that need to be taken in the political sphere that can influence the course of events. The most important development, I think, for the Ukrainians is that they were able to really hold the Russians in Kharkiv Oblast back and not have Russian artillery and rocket artillery getting into the range to fire into Kharkiv city. The situation is bad enough with the glide bombs, but this would really have worsened the situation. Mm. But it seems that at the front lines in the east, Chasiv Yar, Pokrovsk, maybe also in Kremina, Lyman direction, Ukraine will not be able to hold the territory, but it will be a slow delay operation where it can administer losses to the Russian side, but where Ukraine will slowly but steadily give up small villages, towns, and territory. The big question is whether Ukraine will be able to push more on Crimea, maybe make logistics more difficult, take the three bridges out, or at least one of the three or two. Yeah. Because I think Crimea is a military and political pressure point at the same time. And if Ukraine can improve the readiness of the Russian side to go for real talks, then it can be done by pressuring Crimea. Yeah. It's difficult to judge at the moment, but it's also non-understandable from a military point of view why, for example, the ATACMS that clearly show their value by attacking radar sites, air defense systems, command and control on Crimea, why they have been delivered so late. the situation would be much better if all of this would have been done much earlier.
That's an argument that you hear a lot, argument or the sort of concern that you hear a lot, even in DC, that how come we've delayed this so much? So based on
that, I think we have learned, we have to be very clear about this. I mean, it's one thing at the end, eventually arriving at a point where we are doing the right thing. But when we are doing the right thing too late, it might not be enough to win. You have to do the right thing, but you have to do it also at the right time. We have to learn from that.
What do you think about the sort of slight change in the U.S.'s policy towards Ukraine, when the U.S. was telling Ukraine not to take any targets out on the Russian territory using NATO or the American weapons? That sort of has been modified. It has not been fully lifted, at least to my knowledge at this point. But what do you make of that? How was that policy harmful, and how much impact will loosening it will have now?
Well, it goes straight to the point that we had before, doing the right thing, but do it at the right time. From a military point of view, those restrictions never made any sense. It even gave the Russians the opportunity to hide behind the artificial restrictions, to exploit them, and then to attack the Ukrainians from safe ground on the other side of the border. The restrictions are lifted now, and I think the best we all can do is to change this paradigm where we are not delivering weapons, equipment, ammunition to the Ukrainians and telling them what they can do or not do. We should just deliver and then not make any comment on what can be done or not be done, and not tell the other side all of the time where red lines are or self-made restrictions are. Let the Russians guess what the rules of engagement are that we are discussing with the Ukrainians, and not bring this out into the public all of the time.
And let the Ukrainians decide how to use it.
That's best. I mean, it's military logic. So whatever is militarily necessary should be done.
Mm-hmm. Nico, let's move to a different topic now. NATO summit. What are your expectations from the Washington summit as it relates to Ukraine?
Well, I'm personally very much connected to NATO. Many years ago, I worked in a military NATO headquarters. I went on missions for NATO together with NATO partners, and I worked at the Ministry of Defense. So having said that, I'm not in the mood for a celebration, even if it's 75 years, even if we have new members in NATO. I'm not in the mood for celebration because I have the feeling we are not doing what is necessary to defend against Russia and to deter Russia in the future. And that is the task we have to solve. Mm-hmm. And I'm underwhelmed by what is known so far, what the decisions of this historic summit might be. And to be frank, there is a very interesting German saying that says, wir taktieren uns zu Tode. The translation would be, we are tactically playing ourselves to death. Mm-hmm. So, I think it's time for bold strategic decisions about how we see the security order in Europe. It's not the time for small tactical, minor decisions. But unfortunately, some of the major players in this, they are not ready for the bold, strategically important decisions. They just want to be tactical. And I think that's not what is needed to counter the threat that we are facing.
You don't think anything tangible is coming related to Ukraine from the summit?
I think something tangible is coming when it comes to defending NATO as it is today, with the new members, with the military plans, with more commitment by the NATO members, with more countries not only talking about 2%, but really spending 2%. So there, I think, is significant progress, and I don't want to diminish that. It is really there. But when it comes to being strategic about the future security order in Europe, eliminating the gray zones, bringing Ukraine, Moldova, Georgia in, giving Russia less room to play games or to threaten people or to start wars, I think we are not doing what is necessary. And how many opportunities do we need? After Vilnius now in Washington, many things can happen until the next NATO summit. And I'm skeptical because I've experienced the time from 2008 after the NATO summit in Bucharest, where we were trying to tell the Ukrainians, look, European integration is possible without NATO integration.
Yeah.
And I learned that lesson. I was wrong with that story. And the Central Eastern Europeans and the Ukrainians, they are right. And the European integration of Ukraine, investments into Ukraine, a peace order in Europe, I think is not possible without the NATO membership of Ukraine.
Nico, you are based in Germany or now in Spain, I guess. What are the perceptions of the U.S. elections in Europe? Are people concerned? Are people hopeful? How would you analyze that aspect?
There is concern, but that is a concern that I do not like. It's the kind of concern where you are expressing every day how concerned you are. So if you are concerned, what are you doing? I mean, there's not much time. So we have to provide for our own security more, regardless of who will be president of the United States. And on the other hand, I know that we need the transatlantic partnership for European and transatlantic security. So I think everybody in Europe would be very smart not to comment any public statement made by any candidate in the US elections. The Americans will elect whoever they will elect, and we have to find a way to work together with the United States of America. That's in our interest from a German point of view, but I think that's true for many Europeans. So I'm most afraid from a German point of view, I'm most afraid of anti-Americanism coming back. And this kind of using the US elections and a possible result this or that way to again return to anti-American resentments, to creating the impression that we have to move away from the transatlantic partnership. We have seen that before. It's not, from my point of view, it's not in our interest, but it's really dangerous. We will have elections in the year after that in Germany. It would be sad if we would have anti-American campaigns being part of that election.
There was a term used, Trump-proofing, a few weeks ago, as it came to the European sort of security guarantees, or Europe caring more about its own security. So that caused a controversy of a sort in Washington, to Trump-proof something.
I don't know what it means. I don't know what it means. I mean, we have to be able to provide more for our own security. But it's also true that certain, if we talk strictly militarily, there are certain capabilities that we cannot replace very quickly. They are only there in the United States. We have an interest in working together, regardless of who is president. And what does Trump-proof mean? Does it mean to work together with any U.S. administration, which is in our interest? Or does it mean to do something else if somebody we don't like or some of us don't like will become president of the United States? I do not really understand what Trump-proof means. But what I know is that we saw many European policymakers really making big declarations about what Europe should do and what Europe can do. And Europe is not able in the defense and the security sector to live up to those expectations. So I would be careful not to create wrong expectations about self-sufficiency of Europe in security matters. This is a long process. It needs very significant spending. So I think our best shot at this is doing whatever is necessary to keep the transatlantic bond, to keep NATO alive, and to work with any US administration that will be elected. We have worked with different administrations before. We can do it also. Let's see who will be president and then start from there.
Nico, thank you so much.
And there might be, I mean, it's just a little bit provocative talk. As I sometimes tell people here, there might even be countries in the world who don't like the German government or certain German candidates, and still they work together with Germany.
Yeah. Well, we'll see what happens. Very interesting, especially German politics. We won't go into that, but after the European elections, it was sort of a jolt for at least the outside observers to see how cards played out for Germany.
If we are concerned, we have to do something. If we are concerned, then we should make a decision. There's a budget discussion in Germany, not to just 1 year, but permanently spend more than 2% on defense. If we are concerned, then we should, as Europeans, say, if the US is giving $60 billion help in military aid for Ukraine, we should give 60 billion euro. I mean, that's the way, not only to be concerned, but to do practical things that will make the discussions easier with the US and help our security.
Nico, thank you very much for this. I really appreciate your time.